And first of all, thank you guys for having me in here this morning. I know this is a complex campaign. There's a lot of issues in Illinois right now, so thanks for giving me the chance to talk to you about my thoughts on all those. So just a quick background on me. I know I've talked to Bernie a few times, but I'm from Taylorville originally. Went to high school there and grew up there mostly. I'm proud to be from Taylorville. I think there's things you learn growing up in a small town that you don't necessarily get to experience and learn in other places. So I'm proud to be from there. My wife Amy's also from Taylorville. This fall, we will have been together 17 years now. So long time. We've been married for 10 years this summer. After high school, I went to Lincolnland here in town where I got to play baseball. And love Lincolnland. I think community colleges are a great asset to Illinois. After Lincolnland, my wife graduated high school, and we both went to Illinois State together. At Illinois State, I got to major in economics. Enjoyed that. It didn't necessarily help me get a job, but it gave me a nice, broad background that I think helps me today with, everything in life generally. My senior year at Illinois State, I was fortunate to intern for Senator Bill Brady in his Senate office. I enjoyed that very much. I got to know Senator Brady just a little bit, and when he decided to run for governor in 2005-06, I was his aide and travel guy, and really enjoyed getting to do that. I'd been involved in politics and enjoyed politics before that. For Bush Cheney 2000, I got involved putting up signs and walking door to door with my younger brother, and that's kind of really what started me on that path. And then working with Senator Brady kind of furthered that. Now I work in law enforcement here in Springfield. I really enjoy what I get to do. I work in Homeland Security, going to work every day and feeling like you get to make a difference in the world in helping people and protecting people is a great feeling, which really is ultimately, I think, why I decided to run for the Senate. I've spent my career serving people. I really, truly enjoy serving people. And I think that right now, Illinois is at a critical time in its history. I think that, we've got a lot of really tough, pressing issues that too many people don't seem to be willing to tackle head on. And I think that I've spent my career going after those problems and going straight at them rather than trying to, avoid tough decisions and tough problems. I want to help make this state a place where we can be proud to live for now and for the future. And I think that we need more good, honest people in the legislature to help make that happen. So I'm happy to be in this race. I'm proud to be in this race. And I'm looking forward to the next 22 days, I think, until the election. So I'm happy to answer any questions you guys have. And
You're getting a lot of support, million-plus in support from a PAC that's allied with Governor Rauner. Can you walk us through Governor Rauner's turnaround agenda proposals in terms of where you stand in relation to them?
Sure. I make no secret that I support much of what the governor's trying to do. I think I'm Republican for a reason, and that's because I believe in somewhat limited government and fiscal responsibility. And I think that much of what the governor is trying to do right now is get us back to fiscal responsibility in this state. I think that things like tort reform and workers' compensation reform, property tax relief, those are all, in my opinion, the foundations of the Republican platform, which I believe very much in. I think that, unfortunately, Illinois has gotten to a place where we, small businesses, whether it's in Springfield or Jerseyville or Jacksonville, don't feel welcome in the state right now. And I think that what the governor is trying to do is get us to that point. I don't agree with everything he's doing, but I think that for too long we've had legislators and governors who haven't been willing or able to take that head on. And I think that finally we've got someone who's at least trying.
What are some of the areas you don't agree?
Well, as a state employee, I think that it's absolutely crucial for people to have collective bargaining as a right. I think that I disagree with the governor on that. I work with people every day who are nervous right now with the direction the state's headed, and I agree. I think that we're in a tough spot. But I also agree, like I said before, that we have to do something. And I think that that's, you know, where people in this district disagree with the current senator. There are a lot of taxpayers in this district who expect us to be good stewards of their tax dollars. And they, you know, they want to move forward towards fiscal responsibility. There are a couple other areas I disagreed on the governor recently. I think the medical marijuana project or pilot, the additional, you know, the PTSD and some of the other qualifiers that they recommended adding on to that, I thought were good recommendations. And I would have urged the governor to support those. So I was disappointed when he did not do that.
You mentioned collective bargaining. It is the arbitration thing that is a particular vote that Senator McCann took that seems to have gotten him in the bad graces of the governor's office. You say that you agree with the governor that that bill should not pass, there shouldn't be arbitration. But we have heard it. You're also in Lodge 41, the state police trooper, Lodge 41. Aren't they in arbitration now? Don't they have arbitration? And I guess the question is, if your own union has it, why shouldn't
so public safety unions in general are allowed arbitration because, you know, if they were allowed to strike, public safety would be at risk. And I think that that's the biggest difference. To my understanding, that's the biggest difference.
Well, what are DCFS workers less important than state troopers and such things?
Absolutely,
you know,
not. Yeah, it's
that 24 hours you're supposed to go to the family to see if the kid's getting beat up.
Absolutely. The it's a shame that we're in the situation we are in. I think that the absolute right decision and the right path forward is for the governor and the unions to work out a compromise and to work out a fair contract for everyone. You know, I don't know if it was right to go to the Labor Relations Board now, but that was the agreement that they had made previously, was to have that option, whether it be the governor, whether it be the union. So my hope is that they continue to negotiate and come up with a contract.
I know arbitration for AFSCME.
Once again, I think that for to remove the governor from the collective bargaining process, who is the popularly elected person by the people of Illinois, I think that's just the wrong move. I think that we have to let him do what people elected him to do, what he campaigned on doing, and to put that power in the hands of an arbitrator who isn't accountable to anyone ultimately, and leave that much of the budget process in his hands, I think that's not a smart thing for us to do in Illinois.
So recently, Senator McCann was here, and we talked a little bit about a story Bernie had done about his mileage, and we also talked to him about some of the fiscal crisis situations that we're facing, and one of the things that came up in the conversation was he said he wasn't good with numbers. So in this capacity, you really need to be good with numbers. So tell us a little bit about your budget experience and how that you can see that helping in the situation that we're in.
Well, as I mentioned before, I was an economics major at Illinois State. I wouldn't say I'm any expert with a budget or with numbers, but with my current position, I do a lot of procurement. So I work with vendors in the state. I work with budgets. I work with all the things that, quite frankly, is a problem in Illinois right now. I see every day the problems that we have in our vouchering system and in our budgeting and in our quite frankly, it's a mess. So I think that gives me a unique perspective to see where we can possibly begin to save money, where we can cut, and I don't claim to know everything is to where we can cut, but I know the people who do, and I know there's a lot of smart people in state government and every agency who sees the inefficiencies every day because they deal with them just like I do.
Can you walk us through a little bit, you know, because you do have a unique perspective, like how does procurement work and where do you as a state employee see issues where it could be improved?
So the
you need something.
Sure. So I don't deal with every aspect of it, so I have somewhat of a limited scope, but I can tell you that it's basically there's too many approval processes right now, the way I see things. I think that it's necessary to put it out there for competitive bidding. You know, the state does have a competitive bidding vendor list that we have to go to initially to keep costs low. past that, there, and I couldn't tell you how many approval steps it goes through, but I can tell you that I have some purchases that take months that just absolutely shouldn't happen. You know, we have to go through a certain process for even office supplies and just simple things, and I've oftentimes have to spend 2 to 3 times the amount that I could go buy it on Amazon or go to the store down the street and buy it for. So there's a problem with the way we do business right now, and I think that if we are able to simplify things, work with the agency heads, work with the people who work in this area every day to simplify it, because you know the private sector does it, other states do it, and I think the more we can do that, the more we're going to be able to reduce costs in this state.
I think a lot of state, you know, it might take a lot of time, and maybe it's not all appropriate, but a lot of safeguards came in after McGlade, which was
they do,
you know, and other governors have given things to their friends, Democrat and Republican.
Yeah, and it's unfortunate, and I don't disagree with that, but I think that there is room to hopefully move forward and to make some, in my mind, common sense changes to help us do things easier and more efficiently.
Do you actually have an appropriation to buy things?
An appropriation, what? I'm sorry. So I don't have official capacity, but so we lost a person who does our paperwork and all that at the place I work. So over the last year and a half, basically, I have been tasked with doing a lot of our travel vouchers, and I've been tasked with putting together purchasing paperwork. I don't have final approval on those things, but I help shepherd it through the process.
I'm asking a different question.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'd missed
it. State budget. Many state agencies can't buy paper.
I apologize. Okay.
Anything. How do you get to buy things, and can you buy gas?
In my line of work, much of what we do is federally funded. Being that we work in Homeland Security, our appropriations are federally funded. My job is not. I'm a state employee, but our appropriations are federal funds. So we're still able to purchase a lot of the things we do and a lot of the things we need to continue serving. Yes, ma'am.
So,
yes.
Federal, but you don't get any federal pay, do you? Because then you couldn't run for partisan office.
That's correct. Yeah, my job is a state.
You spend federal money, but you're still on the state payroll, paid for by the state, and running for a political office.
Yes, that sounds. My job is not a federally funded job. I think is basically what you're getting at.
How has the has there been any effect from the budget impasse on your office?
I
know you mentioned the secretary leaving. Was that a layoff or a budget impact?
I don't think so. That happened kind of before we got it too deep into the weeds on the budget issues. You know, for years now, the way I've seen it is that the state's got a little bit of a backlog in being able to hire people to keep up with what we need to have happen in the state. So I don't believe it was a budget issue on that portion. I have seen it in other aspects of the state police. And other agencies, I think that, you know, they mentioned to keep the squad cars fueled up because you never know when they're going to turn off the gas cards. And they've mentioned just keeping up on the maintenance because you just don't know when they won't be able to go get oil changes and things like that. So once again, I think it's absolutely crucial that we get back to discussions. You know, the leadership, the governor and the speaker and the Senate president absolutely need to get back to the bargaining table and continue to work on a budget because we've been far too long without one.
Speaking of backlogs, there are quite a few of those right now. What is your understanding of the amount of backlogs monetarily, and what is your understanding of the situation that we're in right now, if you had a round number?
So we're basically spending about $5 billion more than we're taking in, which it doesn't take an economist to know that that can't continue. I think that, once again, we have to continue to work on a budget. You know, I'm fortunate to live 6 minutes from the Capitol, so I absolutely will be at the Capitol nonstop working with other legislators and working with the governor to continue to solve the problems that we have in this state, because I think that the people in this district and the people in this state deserve nothing less, and they demand nothing less than continued work towards that, and I plan to do that.
Given that, you know, you said we need a budget, spending mm-hmm. more than we're taking in and the impact it's already having, is it the right approach to tie the turnaround agenda to the budget?
I think it is. As much as the Speaker Madigan claims that the turnaround agenda is not budgetary. I think that if we start to make the reforms like workers' compensation reform and putting a freeze on our property taxes, it's only going to continue to help build our tax base instead of having to raise taxes to, say, the 5% he requested as a starting point. I think that, you know, the more we're able to encourage small business growth and encourage people to stay in Illinois, the better off we're going to be. Right now, Illinois has one of the highest out migrations in the country, and when you have people leaving the country or leaving the state like they are, we're losing that tax base. And I think that that is not conducive to maintaining, you know, where we need to be in the state.
Have you talked to the local governments in your district to get their opinion on the freezing property?
I've talked to some small town mayors throughout the district who have voiced their concern about where we're heading as a state. And it doesn't take much to see it just driving through these areas. You know, I grew up in Taylorville. You know, when you go to downtown Taylorville, or which obviously isn't in the district, but or downtown Springfield, it doesn't take long to see the empty businesses and the empty restaurants and things like that. So it's very obvious to me and talking to the local elected officials that we need to do something. And I think that they're just looking for somebody to start. Absolutely.
That's their only source of revenue in many cases.
Mm-hmm. So I think that it is a source of revenue, so that's why we have to give them other options in order and to save money if we put a property tax freeze. Illinois has second highest property taxes in the nation, you know, not far behind New Jersey. And I think that's absolutely part of the reason that we have the people leaving the state and the small businesses leaving the state like we do.
The property tax freeze that the governor wants, he thinks that can only go in if local governments are given the option not to pay prevailing wage and to decide what to collectively bargain on with their employees. I think you said you agreed with that.
I do.
Okay, but you just said collective bargaining is important, so it's important except for local governments who don't want to use it.
I'm in favor of collective bargaining, absolutely, but I think that you have to give local governments the option to do what they need to do in their areas. I think that having state oversight only creates a situation where you're handcuffing people to be able to help their local communities in the ways they need to. I think that being a supporter of collective bargaining doesn't mean that collective bargaining has to have free rein all the time. I think that you can support individual workers and not necessarily support unlimited collective bargaining.
So you would favor it for state employees and you favor then local governments having the option to
I believe so. I think it's at least giving them that option.
When Senator McCann was here, he talked about how 95% to 99% of the calls he got from people in the district said they wanted him to vote the way he did on 1229, which is the arbitration, allowing an impasse in negotiations to go to arbitration. He says, how can you be a representative if you don't do what that many of your constituents want? What are you hearing, and why is it right that you take a position against that?
I think that I've talked to a lot of people in this district, knocking on their doors and going to events, and a lot of people have told me that they called Senator McCann leading up to that vote and urged him very strongly not to vote the way he did. You know, we have over 200,000 taxpayers in this district, and I think that those people are looking for someone who represents the entire district and not just a certain portion of the district. I'm a portion of that district. I'm a state worker and I'm a taxpayer, and I think that you, like I said previously, you can stand up for state workers and for public sector union members, and not have to bow down to the every demand of big labor. And I think that that's what our current senator has forgotten. And I think that people in the district have, you know, they deserve better than that.
Generally, philosophically, you know, that is kind of an interesting question. How do you balance, if you were a state senator, let's say you get 80% of your calls are going one way and you feel you're inclined to go the other way? How do you approach that generally, philosophically?
I think that generally that's not going to be a problem, because the popularly elected people in this state and in this country are elected because the majority of the people agree with their positions, and that's why they're elected. I do think you absolutely have to listen to what your constituents are telling you, and I plan to do that wholeheartedly.
But how would you probably fall if, you know, say constituents are telling you one thing and you not sure you agree with them.
I think that you have to stick to your morals. There are certain things that are non-negotiable in this world. I feel like I have a strong moral compass, so I will never go back and go counter to those. But I think when you're talking about budget issues and things that are going to get the state back on the right track, I'm the kind of person who likes to listen more than I like to talk. So I'm absolutely going to seek the opinion of other people, and I absolutely will listen to the opinions of other people when they've convinced me that I'm wrong.
There's the comptroller says that 5% wouldn't even do it now. It would have to be 7 or 8 percent in income tax. With your economics background, how are you going to raise money? The governor has talked about sales tax, broadening the sales tax base. What options are you open to?
I'm generally opposed to any revenue increases until we get the structural reforms that we need in the state.
Which means that we continue to not fund government and we're $5 billion in the hole going for 25 by 2020.
We have to continue to negotiate a budget. We absolutely have to. Because if we, like you said, if we continue down the path that we're on, we're going to go deeper and deeper into the hole. I think we have to get the structural reforms in place in this state soon so we can start growing business again, so we can start getting that natural tax base back into the equation.
That is avoiding the question of what taxes would you be open to at the appropriate time?
Like I mentioned, I don't want to even consider what taxes I'm going to be open to until we get those things in, because I think that's just premature to do.
Do you think the governor's correct in saying that at some point it may have to happen? I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, the governor has said.
He has said that, sure. He has, but he's also said we have to have those structural reforms before he'll consider it. So,
would you vote for the 3.5 or that unbalanced budget act, just let the governor cut?
Would I vote for the budget
that he gave the legislature the other day? Just let the governor, cut.
I think that the best option is for the legislature to pass a budget like their job is to do. I think that we have to have people doing what they were elected to do in this state, and unfortunately the legislature is not producing a budget and not producing the agenda items that are going to get us to where we need to be as a state. I think that the leadership needs to continue to work towards that. The legislature needs to help them with that, but in the end, if that doesn't happen, I do support giving the governor that option as a way to get our state where it needs to be so we can pay the bills that are going to keep us running.
Bryce, there are probably a multitude of businesses within your district that do business with the state that are, A, not being paid right now because there's no appropriation, although we're incurring their services or B, no longer working with the state and losing revenue because they can't afford the cash flow problems. What is your moral compass tell you about that situation?
It's incredibly unfortunate. It's
so why should it go on?
It shouldn't. It absolutely shouldn't. We've got to start working together to get a budget. As I've said before, I deal with vendors regularly who are months behind. Even in my situation where we do have federal funds available, the backlog of bills we're months behind on payments. So it's incredibly unfortunate, and I pray that they get through these challenging times, because it is a tough time right now. So we have to continue to work, and it's, I know I sound like a broken record there, but the only way this is going to get done is for everybody to continue to come to the Capitol, continue to work together, and to find the answers that are going to get us through this mess.
So if you're an economics major, describe the world in 4 years. If this budget impasse goes on another year, which a lot of pundits think is not untrue, unrealistic, which a year ago we all would have said, no way. And you look at the damage that's being done in the meantime to the business community as a result of the budget impasse, how long will it take for the state to repair itself after this period?
It's a good question. That's a good question, and I don't know the answer to that, and that's why we have to continue to work. Because, honestly, if we don't, as you know and as everyone here knows, it could be years, it could be decades for us to repair if we don't get something done, and I'm absolutely committed to getting that done. I think that we've, as I said before, I don't agree with everything the governor does, and I don't agree that with the way he goes about doing certain things, but I think that he is trying to get Illinois on the right track. I believe that, and I believe that we all, that everyone has to work together across the aisle to get a budget in place so that we don't continue down the negative path we're on.
What are significant areas that you believe could be reduced or efficiencies that would present significant savings? We've talked to other legislators, and they've given us things that were a total of about $100,000 or other items, and that's really not going to get us anywhere. Where do you see some significant changes that will change that trajectory?
Sure. I think that Medicaid reform is absolutely necessary. I think that the state started on the right path a few years ago with the eligibility reforms. I think that we need to do everything we can to reduce waste and fraud in that system, including the possibility of biannual eligibility assessments. I think that, you know, that's one of the big areas where by the statistics I've read, we could be talking about tens and hundreds of millions of dollars in savings due to Medicare waste and fraud, or I'm sorry, Medicaid waste and fraud.
Tens of millions of dollars?
Yes, ma'am.
We're looking at billions of dollars.
So it's a start, right.
Cut. So if you go along with the Unbalanced Budget Act, where you cut $4 billion, not $4 million?
I think that we have to give the legislature time, hopefully not much time, to get a budget enacted. And if we don't, as unfortunate it is, as it would be, we need to give the governor the option and the ability to come in and make the cuts where he sees necessary, including the possibility of fund sweeps. No one wants to see fund sweeps again.
It's one
but
time. You know that as an economist, that's just
horrible. It is. But until we get to the place where we have a budget, we can't let, you know, our universities fail. We can't let the vital services in this state fail just because lawmakers in this state are unable to work together and get a budget.
Are there state programs that we're doing that we just shouldn't be doing because, you know, the scope of the cuts we're facing? Where do you get to billions?
I think that you have to start with inefficiencies and waste within each. I'm not prepared to talk about any. I'm sure that there are. I don't want to. I do.
Why? How much travel do you have to do if you work in the Franklin Life Building?
I actually don't work in the Franklin Life Building, but
I thought you did.
I used to. Yes, sir.
So where are you now?
I'm out on, we're co-housed with IEMA.
Okay, so if you're in intelligence and you're going over data, then why do you need a car?
I still do have functions outside of the office as well. I'd rather stay out of the state police aspect of what I do. I don't want to imply any conflict of interest between my political side and the state police side. I'd be happy to talk to you offline about all that. But
so what about education funding, for instance? Mm-hmm. Where, you know, you just mentioned not wanting to cut the universities.
Mm-hmm.
I believe the current budget proposal has 16%.
25, isn't it?
Yeah.
And almost 33 last year, and the governor didn't even mention colleges, universities in his budget address.
Mm-hmm.
So do you feel like, that's something that's going to have to be done?
I think that educating children is the most important thing we can do as a society. Everything starts from that point moving forward. I think that our education system and our universities in Illinois need to be world class. Right now we've got a lot of people, including good friends of mine growing up, who left Illinois to go to college elsewhere because they saw more opportunity there. And I can tell you, once they left, they didn't come back to Illinois. So I think that we have to figure out a way to fund colleges. I think in the short term, during this unprecedented budget crisis, we should give universities and schools the option of borrowing money, which right now right now is not an option, so they should have the ability to borrow money without coming to the government to do that. That's not a long-term plan. That's not a long-term solution, but I think they have to be able to keep their doors open, and I think that that's a way to do that.
Should the state borrow money in order to pay its bills? Our current bills, not bond issues, but current bills.
I think that's a possibility, yes.
Really?
It's a possibility. That's not my first option. Once again, I think that we've got legislators who aren't doing their job to get us a budget. So in as a, it would be a possibility.
The governor submitted a budget that was $4 billion out of balance himself. Am I correct about that? The budget, and he said either, you know, you fix that budget or you give me the Unbalanced Budget Act and I'll cut it.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think about that?
As I've said before, I don't agree with everything the governor's doing. I think that we have to have the option to cut where we need to cut. And if the governor is asking for that power and we can't get a budget otherwise, let the governor have that power. If people aren't a fan of the way he does things, just like legislators, if we do things, if the legislators in the General Assembly do things that are they shouldn't do and that people don't like, they're going to get voted out, and that's the way that this system should work. So I think that we absolutely need a budget, but moving forward, we have, you know, in unprecedented times, we have to have unprecedented options available to get the state where it needs to be.
Can you give us an example? In the turnaround agenda, workers' comp reform is one of the topics. With your constituents that you would have, give us a real-life example of how that would play out.
So I haven't heard from business owners in my district anything specifically, but I can tell you they've told me time and time again that that's one of the biggest costs that they have as a small business. Right now, Illinois versus Indiana, for example, I believe it's three times more costly in Illinois for that cost. And that's just another example of why small businesses don't feel welcome in Illinois right now. And that's unfortunate. I think we have to give them incentives to stay here, give them incentives to grow here. Otherwise, we're going to continue down the same path we're on. We're going to lose workers. We're going to lose that tax base even further, and that's going to put us in an even tougher spot.
So far, as of last week, with the new ad by Dan Croft and Liberty Principles, and he's, of course, a guy that played sixth for governor a few years back and has a talk show in Chicago, and he's funding money from friends of the governor, basically. So that was a $640,000 buy last week with the cards. He's been running ads that have you in your uniform, which they wouldn't allow if you ran the ads yourself, and you don't even want to talk about your job here. He links, Sam McCann and Mike Madigan's favorite senator, Fred Floreth, our 13th Congressional District Republican, member of the State Central Committee, said that you should, denounce those ads. I haven't heard a word from you denouncing anything. In fact, you have kind of on the travel thing, you've said voters should deserve better than an unethical state senator working with Mike Madigan to raise taxes, which Sam says he's never voted for a tax increase, but because of the arbitration bill, he's taking the governor's numbers, $3 billion over 3 years. Why do you let Dan, what do you feel about the fact that this outside person basically said anybody who takes anything from organized labor shouldn't be in a Republican? What do you think of that person basically presenting you mostly to the public and attacking your opponent and promoting you?
So, of course, we can't coordinate any of that, being that it's a third. Right, sure. I'm happy to have the support. I think that I got into this race at a late point in November. As I explored going for Raymond Poe's former seat in the House, I talked to a lot of people around the district. I talked to friends and family who basically pointed me in the direction of the Senate. They said, talk to the business owners, talk to the taxpayers in this district and find out if they're being represented the way they want to be represented in the Senate. So through all that discussion, I ended up deciding to run for the Senate. It's a daunting task going up against any incumbent. And I think that, to have the support of Mr. Proft, and who I've never met, by the way, and of course, Mr. Proft's not the only person who's supporting my campaign. I've received the endorsement of Raymond Poe. I received the endorsement of the governor, Illinois Network of Charter Schools. I've got many endorsements of people who believe that the way forward in the Senate and the way forward in this state is not with our current senator, and they're looking for a change. So, in short, I'm happy for this support.
Did you have to take a leave of absence?
By our policy, I would not, but I think that even though this is a part-time job, technically, I think to do it correctly, it's something that you need to focus a lot more than part-time efforts on, so I do plan on taking leave, yes.
Do you believe in term limits?
I do. Absolutely believe in term limits. I think that, you know, Mike Madigan's been the Speaker of the House almost as long as I've been alive, and that's just not, that's not conducive to serving the people of Illinois. When you've got as much power as the Speaker does and other people in the legislature, it's tough to keep in mind the interests of the people of Illinois. I would absolutely support a term limit bill. I don't plan on taking a pension, a legislative pension. I think that that's just one more thing that encourages people to stay too long in politics. I think the system was designed to have citizen legislators who come in and serve people and go back to what they do full-time, and that's, that is my plan, is to forego a legislative pension.
Would you support term limits for all legislators and not just leadership?
I would. Absolutely. I would be open to starting with a leadership term limit bill, but I think that a bill I would absolutely support is term limits on all legislators.
What do you think those should be?
I think 10 years is a good number. I'd be open to other suggestions as well, but I think 10 years is a good starting point for discussion.
As a leader or a legislator?
As a legislator.
What about leadership?
I think that if you start with 10 years for everyone, that, of course, limits the terms for leadership. And I would also plan to sponsor a bill to eliminate legislative pensions. I think that leaving it in the hands of legislators to take or not take a pension leaves too much room for discussion. So I think that I would sponsor a bill to take that perk away.
Good luck with passing
that. It's a tall task, I know. I know no one's going to willingly, or many people are not going to willingly vote to get rid of their own pension, but I think it's important in the state right now.
I want to double back, if we can, for a second to education. We talked about funding, but one of the big issues right now is the funding formula and mm-hmm. how schools are treated. Andy Menard's bill, well, let's just throw that out as a starting point. What's your position in relation to it?
Sure. I'd be interested to see what the third iteration of it shows. I think in general, though, you have to get to a point where you have students who aren't penalized based on where they live in the state. So whether it's the collar counties in Chicago area or Pawnee or any of the areas in the 50th district, to punish a student based on where they live in the form and the funding that comes to them is unfortunate. So we have to look at a system where there's not winners and losers. And I think I'm looking forward to reading more in his bill once it's released.
So you fall on the side of that you can't take from the other districts to reallocate to them?
I think it has to be fair. I'm not saying that you can't take from them. I think it has to be fair, though. But, you know, if you're talking $100,000 increase for 186, for example, is it fair to cut a school like Pawnee or to cut $100,000 from 186 and fund 30,000 to Pawnee? I don't know the answer to that 100%, but I think those are just hypotheticals. Those aren't real numbers, right?
Like the suburban schools are spending 20,000 and 30,000 for students. Should mm-hmm. they take any cut in state funding in order for districts in your territory to get a little more?
I think that that's absolutely an option. I don't, like I said, I'll be interested to see the specifics of it, because I can tell you that the rural schools in places like 50th District, they are hurting and they need more money, and I think that we need to explore options to increase that.
Sam McCann and you are both, I think, social conservatives. Any differences that you can see? I know that you've had some competing groups, even the Illinois Family Institute for him, Illinois Family PAC, which got some money from Mr. Uline, and it's for you. Pro-family, pro-life, some of these groups don't do guns, but you're also pro-Second Amendment. All pretty much the same, you and McCann, as far as the choice voters have there?
I'm very much a conservative. I would argue in some senses I'm a more consistent conservative than my opponent. Well, I vote in all Republican primaries. I take every chance I get to support Republican ideals and local candidates. My opponent has only voted in primaries when he's on the ballot primarily. I think that we need someone who's going to consistently stand up for the values that we believe in. My opponent threatened to run as an independent for governor. There were petitions passed.
Petitions.
Right, there were petitions passed. Well, and he didn't vote in the primary before that. I think for that, right, possibly for that reason. So I think that we need someone who consistently stands up for Republican principles, and I think I'll be that person.
What other, you know, right now with the state of things over at the Capitol, the budget is overshadowing a lot, but what other priorities would you push for if you were elected? You know, are there any particular issues?
I think that I bring a unique law enforcement perspective, and there's not any specific issues there, but I think that given my contacts and my experiences there, I can be a voice for certain issues there. And overall, I think the thing that I've learned about as I've traveled the district is just restoring trust. And I know that's not necessarily a specific legislative issue, but when you don't, when people in your district don't feel like they have trust in their elected officials, then nothing seems to move forward. And I think that that's important, is restoring that, because right now I know there are a lot of people who don't feel like that's the case.
I think a lot of voters may feel that legislators are locked up behind their leaders right now. Do you think that's a fair characterization?
I think it seems to be the characterization, and that's I don't disagree as an outsider looking in right now. I might feel the same way. I think that that's unfortunate, and I think the way to overcome that is to get out into the district, talk to people, find out what the issues are, and bring them back to the state house and deal with it. And that's, once again, if that means agreeing with the governor, agreeing with leadership, then absolutely. If that means changing their mind on an issue, then that's what I plan to do as well.
So did you say before you could actually be a state policeman and be in the legislature at the same time? Has anybody ever done that?
Not to my knowledge. Not to my knowledge. I believe, and I could be wrong on that. I know there's not a specific policy at my workplace against it, but once again, I don't. It doesn't matter in my situation because I will take a leave when I'm elected.
What would you say for people that, because the governor has endorsed you, they believe that you will not be able to stand up if you do not agree with his perspective? What would you say to people who haven't made up their mind and they're trying to decide and they don't want someone in the office that's going to vote just along party lines, but for what is going to get the state out of this mess?
What I would tell them is that I've spent my career serving people. I very much enjoy serving people and listening and pushing those ideas and ideals. As I mentioned before, I am a Republican. I agree in the Republican platform. I agree in much of what the governor is doing. But I will absolutely tell the governor when I think he's wrong, and I'll support him when I think he's right.
The only elected position you've had so far is the Convention Center Board?
Yes, sir.
Which you've had since last April, is it?
Uh-huh.
So how would you describe what you've done there?
It didn't, and we're still waiting on final numbers, and we're working on additional negotiations with the Illini to try to minimize any negative impact that we felt with that. I think that it's important in Springfield and my position on that board to try to get us growing as a community, and I think that part of that includes the convention center. I think the more we can have out-of-town and out-of-state conventions here in Springfield, that'll grow the local economy, you know, the hotels and the restaurants and things like that, the better off we're going to be. You know, our management at the convention center brought us that as an idea to bring in the Illini. I thought it was a good idea to get community involvement and to, you know, basically just have fun. You know, there are a lot of Illini alumni here in Springfield who were very vocal in saying, hey, let's do this.
You know what the numbers are?
I don't offhand. And like I said, we're still working on, we're still working with the Illini on future engagements so that we can minimize any of that. So until that's all squared away, we don't know what the loss or gain will be from that whole contract.
Does that building even have an elected board?
I think that... I think that that's something to consider moving forward, but I think any oversight is good.
So, but we got 7,000 units of government. That's one of them.
We do.
The governor doesn't like 7,000 units of government. Neither do a lot of other people.
So we're an unpaid bipartisan board. So I think that our situation's a little bit unique in that perspective. We more or less give oversight to make sure that people are doing their due diligence within the convention center to spend taxpayer dollars wisely. And I think that we do, overall, we do a good job of that. And we're not, like I said, we're not a hit on the economy as far as salaries or anything like that.
Are there units of local government? I mean, first off, do you agree with the governor that there are too many units of local government? And if so, what would you look at?
I think that we should incentivize local units of government to possibly consolidate. I think that those are decisions that are probably best left up to local communities, because they know where the inefficiencies are. Once again, when you start getting mandates from the state, it tends to slow things down. It tends to make things a lot more complicated than they need to be. So if we give local government the opportunities to consolidate and to do the things they need to do to enact cost savings, I think that would be the way to move forward.
Can we move back to the Prairie Capital Convention Center? Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit about your board position there. How did you get put on the board, and what are some of the things that you do as a board member?
So it's a fairly minimal commitment on the board. We meet once a month. What I try to do as a board member is talk to people in the community and find out what they'd like to see at the convention center, the things that they think are good, the things that they think are bad, and present those to our management at the center. As a board member, we're not intricately involved in the day-to-day operations. As I mentioned before, I think we're more or less there to provide oversight and to make sure that the things that are going on there are in the best interest of the taxpayers.
And how did you get put on the board?
It was an elected position. I was elected last April. It's a district-wide election.
Well, it's one of five sub-districts, right?
Correct.
So you were one person from...
Correct. Yeah. Yes, sir.
You replaced who?
You know what? That's a good question. Okay. I don't remember.
Were you involved with the Trump... when Trump came to town, I think there were
10,000 people.
We approved it. We didn't organize it. That was the management. And I don't know. I believe the Trump people came to the center and were looking for a place to have their rally. And, of course, that was no endorsement of Mr. Trump or his campaign, but we were happy to have an event in downtown Springfield that was going to bring 10,000 people to the center. And ultimately, I think it was great for the city and great for the local businesses.
And you have to mention your wife now.
My wife was a singer at the event. They called her, I think, a day or two before the event and asked if she would be interested in singing the national anthem and God Bless America. And she did a great job. She sings, you know, she's a songwriter and singer, and back and forth between here and Nashville and every other place playing shows.
Do you have a favorite for president, as long as you're Republican running for state senate?
I don't. I haven't decided who I'm voting for yet. I think that, quite frankly, any of the options are better than Senator Clinton or Sanders, but I haven't decided who I'm voting for at this point.
With Springfield, if you drive up and down Monroe as an example, maybe not up and down, but up Monroe, and you notice the open businesses that we have, as an example, Downtown Springfield Incorporated has put together different plans trying to revitalize business here. What would you say you would bring to the table that would help in the business sector?
I think an open mind and an open door. You know, I've met a lot of small business owners throughout the district. You know, my mother-in-law sells goods at a shop downtown Springfield who relies on small vendors here to keep its doors open. I think that we need someone who is going to be pro-business and starts moving towards the reforms they need to be able to be successful. And I think that that's the biggest thing I bring, is an open mind to those ideas.
Okay. Well, we've hit the 45-minute. Anyone have any last questions? Any point you want to make that we didn't cover?
Not really. I mean, I thank you again for letting me be here this morning, for talking to you guys, and for just being able to talk about the issues that are important to this district. My wife Amy and I don't have any kids right now, but someday we will. And I think that, you know, a lot of the reason that I want to run for this district in the state senate is to get Illinois back on the right path, to where I can be proud to raise a child here and where they can be proud to grow up. I had a lot of opportunities growing up in Illinois that, you know, I want to still be there when I have children someday. And I feel like we're on the wrong path right now, and it's unfortunate, and I'll do everything I can to get us back on the right path. So, again, thank you guys for having me here today, and I've enjoyed it.